surprises. We asked at the top of our show, what's been the biggest surprise to you this season and why? We wanted you to tweet us using hashtag NHL Tonight. And boy, you did. So let's roll through a couple of these. Our first one from Jason. It's hard not to say the Isles are not the biggest surprise in the league right now. Second in the East, as many people suspected, they'd be last in the league with the Sens. Micah says, a very big surprise this year has been Nika Zibanejad and his all-star caliber play this year.
That's a good call.
Yeah, in my mind, he is the team's future captain and has the potential to be a top player. All right, we like that one. How about GBS92? My biggest surprise is the 60-goal pace Alex Ovechkin is on. I thought he'd be a little tired from the summer. I'm with you.
He's on a liquid diet,
how do you
though?
Get tired standing over there and just firing the puck and then the power play?
Swinging the fountain
in
the summer.
He's phenomenal.
All right. John Keller, real, as opposed to fake John Keller. The biggest surprise to me is how people still compare Crosby and McDavid after all the insane things Crosby has done in his career.
Fair. Right. It's actually.
You're right.
It's fair.
Yeah?
Yeah.
But I get why they do it, but they're comparing players.
Superstars, we manufacture it all the time, right? That's what we want to see.
That's what we do.
All right. How about Ginger? If the St. Louis Blues can sustain their current run, I would say they're my biggest surprise, considering everything they've been through this year. I think a lot of people are on that bandwagon, Ginger. How about JM74 NAB, the new energy in second half record of the Carolina Hurricanes? Hashtag take warning. Hashtag those jerks down there in Raleigh just keep on winning, huh? At P Divine 79, the Blues turnaround. Team was dead in the water with deadline on Monday. How much does the team's current chemistry affect trade decisions? Oh, and that was a question. So that wasn't just a statement. That was
sure.
a question.
Bring
so
on.
How much do you think it does affect trade deadline with St. Louis and what they're trying to do here?
Well, for me, first of all, it took them how long to get to this point, find the chemistry, find the closeness in that room? I don't think you messed
with
this
it. But this is what we expected, right? The offseason with all the additions.
This is why it's a surprise. Surprise the way they started.
Yeah.
It's a surprise.
Double surprise.
They're able to get out of that deep hole they dug themselves and play so well right now. It's just hard to believe you can have two separate teams do what they did. And that's why, for me, they're the biggest surprise. But, I mean, this team is – Doug Armstrong has to be saying, hallelujah. This is what I envisioned when I made these moves in the offseason. You know, getting Ryan O'Reilly, getting Bozak, who's a really good quality, smart player. And they just – they never gelled. They never gelled, never got on course. Tarasenko is coming off an injury, wasn't great, maybe wasn't in great shape. Now he's finding his game. They're all happy. I mean, this is a good team. I mean, I don't know. What do you make some moves? Maybe, but I mean, right now, I don't know
if
Doug wants to touch anything after the way he started.
If they could get a guy for the power play, see, is it a power play QB? Is it a guy like Vanek? See, I don't see a guy like Vanek going there. I mean, but probably not. I agree with you. This team we all thought would be great to start the year, but what they had issue at the start of the year, Scott, was finding their roles. Too many of these veteran players that had been there for a while didn't know where they fit, which is odd to say, right? Because you think that they would understand where they are, but maybe with all the changes that happened there, maybe we didn't give it enough credence that sometimes even it takes veteran players a while. And the other thing is, look, I mean, it's a big deal. They got a guy that's communicating with them differently, and for some reason it's getting through more in Craig Berube versus what was there before. That's and sometimes it's just different messenger.
Maybe just holding them more accountable. I mean,
but part of that's communication.
Yeah, communication. Yeah, maybe drawing a line in the sand at times. But
if I had told you guys Jordan Binnington was going to be the go-to guy at this point in the season, you would have told me.
No, I mean, right. He wasn't in.
Who?
Exactly.
Right. He was pretty far down the Blues depth chart.
Yes.
Right.
Let alone anyone else's. So it's been phenomenal. But one guy that's been phenomenal is Ryan O'Reilly.
Yeah.
You got to give him kudos.
All year.
Start.
I mean,
of
all
the
year.
Too. Yeah.
He didn't. He knew where he fit. When he came, he was traded, and he never – it's interesting. He was the guy that you could say, well, where he might have the biggest issue knowing where he fits. He just came in and said, I'm going to show you where I fit. I'm going to take the game to the ice.
And could we maybe give him a vote for the Selke, maybe? I mean,
absolutely.
I look at his numbers here. I mean, he's a plus 25. There's not many guys close on his team to that plus 25. And the way they started, they were last at one point in the National Hockey League. And you look at Bergeron. I know Bergeron's played less games. He's got 56 points, Bergeron, plus 15, 61 for Ryan O'Reilly, 59 games played. But, I mean, this guy's top five faceoffs, very important stat. Takeaways, he's top four
EK.
Or five in takeaways. We saw the movie he did last night, the defensive play to offensive goal. Mm-hmm. Face. I mean, this guy's a quality 200-foot player that plays the right way. So you got to like him.
He's
maybe.
Up there for sure.
Absolutely.
Right. He's in the conversation. What didn't you see coming this season?
Well, I couldn't agree more with a bunch of the fans that tweeted in and responded to us about the New York Islanders, but in particular for the Islanders, in particular. I mean, Trotz, you know, who would have thought that they'd be able to readjust this quickly and really implement just a different system and everybody working so well. It's the goaltending for me in particular, and I did not see this coming. Please don't tell me that everybody says, I knew Thomas Greiss was that good. I like Thomas Greiss, I do. But his career save percentage is .915. This year he's a .930 save percentage. Robin Leonard, his career save percentage is .917. He's at .929. Their save percent, their goals against averages, I mean, are both well below what their careers have been at. Yes, they're platooning. I know it's part and parcel to what they've done systematically from an X and O perspective. It's different. We talked about how well they net cover, how well that they stack the line, how well that they've all bought in many ways, not all, but in many ways, Scotty, it's similar to Vegas last year with how hard they're skating, where they're covering the ice, where they're getting the puck, and what they're then transitioning to it. They don't have the offense that Vegas had last year.
Might be better defensively, though.
I'd agree about that, but it has a similar vibe. But yep. I did not see these two goaltenders, and I think it says an awful lot to Mitch Korn.
And a young D. For the most part.
Yeah, and with younger D. Yep. Honestly, I don't look at that D, even the older guys, as being like, oh, those are shutdown guys right there.
They've learned a lot.
They're solid. But those goalies, I did not see that coming. I did not see it coming.
A couple moves that I like that Lou Lamoriello did, I like Komarov. This guy's a workhorse, comes to play. He's been very good. Not scoring a lot of points, but just a nice fit here. Lou Noom in Toronto and Matt Martin coming back, making this fourth line. Possibly one of the best fourth lines in the league.
Yeah.
Casey Zizekas, I know he's played a bit third line. He's got 16, 17 goals. Matt Martin, he wasn't even playing in Toronto. This is one of the best fourth lines in hockey. Barry Trotz can play any these lines against anybody on the ice. That fourth line can play against any top line in the league and have success.
Right.
Amazing.
And you look at the difference in goals.
And that's a luxury to have.
From dead last in the NHL to the top dog in that department.
Yeah, unbelievable. I mean, I didn't see that coming either. I didn't think they'd be a good team. I didn't think they'd be, 31st. I did not think that. But I did not see them. I mean, if I'm being honest, I did not have them making the playoffs this year. I didn't see them being the worst of the worst. Because I'm like, yeah, they still got other good pieces and everything. But you bring up Matt Martin.
Yeah.
You bring a guy back that desperately wanted to be back on the island.
Players loved him, too.
And he wanted to be there.
Yes.
And so I think that helps, big brother comes home into the locker room, makes everybody feel good despite losing John Tavares. The buy-in on this team has been spectacular. It starts with Lou, then to the coach. It just goes to show what a change in leadership, and I'm talking up top leadership can do for this team. It resonates throughout the rest of the team.
But I think they rallied around the Tavares thing. I think they used that.
And they're still using it. We're still here.
Just like Vegas used, hey, we were cast-offs. They used that. They're having a little more trouble this year. Right now, this is what the Islanders are losing, are using to have success and show people, hey, we don't need John Tavares. Yes, he would have been nice to have, but we can win without him. Other guys are going to have more responsibilities, and that's what's going on there right now.
And they're playing the right way.
They're playing defense.
Yeah,
they're giving up a lot less shots.
I've heard he likes that a little bit.
Yes,
playoff games at the Coliseum.
They're actually blocking
some
shots.
Either.
Yeah, they're playing well.
I agree with a couple of people that tweeted in about Ovi. How about 42 goals? He's on pace for a 60 goal season. And if everything he went through, and how about the summer he had? If there was ever going to be a year that this guy would maybe get out of the gate slow or maybe just get 30, no.
What was his name? Robin Leach.
Yeah.
Caviar Dreams summer.
He's in great shape. He's been working out with the Stanley Cup. Look at him.
He was pressing it, curling it.
He was on a liquid diet.
So was I in college, but it didn't work out quite like that.
He actually came back. His body fat was 1% lower this year than it was last year. And he was his weight was at below.
He must have had an extra glass of water.
He may have, right?
But still, in all seriousness, 42 goals. He is on pace for 60 goals.
I agree.
Who saw that coming?
I didn't see that coming.
Let's be realistic, though. How many does he score from that spot in the power play?
Does it matter?
So it shouldn't be
60 goals or 60
goals,
but, right?
But every time he shoots it from there, it goes in. And it's like, does
but
he
they
actually,
have the book on him
it's
now.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Who has a book? Not the goalies.
but we all know it's coming, and
yeah,
you still
I know.
Can't do anything.
I hear you. It's
they
amazing.
Have the,
I,
they have
I love
the book
it.
Wide up with big block letters, huge letters, huge font. They're all reading it. He's going to shoot from the left side, and none of them can still use the book to help him stop it.